We would like to welcome you to this very special Easter program.
This presentation is a collaboration between the Media Department and the Music Department.
And as all Christendom is celebrating the Passion, the Death, and Resurrection of Jesus,
we hope that you can find that message of hope in every song and in the spoken word.
And with that, once again, we're so glad you're here. We're going to start the presentation with prayer with Pastor Randy.
Friends, I'm delighted you've joined us for this Easter concert. Would you now join me in prayer? Gracious God, our hearts are filled with eagerness and anticipation. We're filled with that eagerness and anticipation because of the empty tomb of Christ. Together, as we celebrate that event, might you fill us with the peace of Jesus, with the power of the Spirit, and with the hope of the gospel. Be with us during this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Then Jesus went with them to a garden called Gethsemane and told his disciples, "Stay here while I go over there and pray." And taking along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he plunged into an agonizing sorrow. Then he said, "This sorrow is crushing my life out. Stay here and keep vigil with me." Going on a little ahead, he fell on his face, praying, "My Father, if there is any way, get me out of this. But please, not what I want. You, what do you want?" When he came back to his disciples, he found them sound asleep. He said to Peter, "Can't you stick it out with me a single hour? Stay alert. Be in prayer so that you don't wander into temptation without even knowing you're in danger. There's a part of you that is eager and ready for anything in God. There's another part that's as lazy as an old dog lying by the fire." He then went back a second time, again praying, "My Father, If there is no other way than this, drinking this cup to the dregs, I'm ready. Do it your way. When he came back, he again found them sound asleep. They simply couldn't keep their eyes open. This time, he let them sleep on and went back a third time to pray. Going over the same ground one last time.
It was an old custom during the festival for the governor to pardon a single prisoner named by the crown. Now, at that time, they had the infamous Jesus Barabbas in prison. With the crowd before him, Pilate asked, "Who do you want me to pardon? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus the so-called Christ?" Now, Pilate knew it was through sheer spite that they had turned Jesus over to him. While court was still in session, Pilate's wife sent him a message. Do not get mixed up in the judging of this noble man, for I've just had a long and troubled night because of a dream I had about him. Meanwhile, the priests and religious leaders were talking the crowd into asking for the pardon of Barabbas and the execution of Jesus. The governor, Pilate, asked, which of the two do you want me to pardon? Well, the crowd said, Barabbas. Then what do you want me to do with Jesus, the so-called Christ? They shouted, nail him to a cross. Pilate objected, but for what cause? They shouted all the louder, nail him to a cross. When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere and that a riot was imminent, he took a basin of water and washed his hands in the full sight of the crowd, saying, I wash my hands of the responsibility of this man's death. From here on, he's in your hands, you are judge and jury. Well, the crowd responded, we'll take the blame, we and our children after us. Then Pilate pardoned Barabbas, but he had Jesus whipped and then handed over for crucifixion.
Crown, what king reigns? saith wrong to choose me. What love in death can set us free? What king rejects a throne to choose me? What love in death can set us free?
Along the way, they came on a man from Cyrene named Simon and made him carry Jesus' cross. Arriving at Golgotha, the place they call Skull Hill, they offered him a mild painkiller, a mixture of wine and myrrh, but when he tasted it, he wouldn't drink it. After they finished nailing him to the cross and were waiting for him to die, They threw dice for his clothes to kill time. Above his head, they posted the criminal charge against him. Here's Jesus, the King of the Jews. Along with him, they also crucified two criminals, one on his right and the other to his left. People passing along the road jeered, shaking their heads in mock lament. You brag that you could tear down the temple and then rebuild it in 3 days? So show us your stuff, save yourself. If you're really God's son, come down from that cross. The high priests, along with the religion leaders and scholars, were right there mixing it up with the rest of them, having a great time poking fun at them. The King of Israel, is he? He saved others, he can't save himself. Well, then come down from that cross. We'll all become believers then. He was so sure of God. Well, let him save his son now, if he wants him. He did claim to be God's son, didn't he? Even the two criminals crucified next to him joined in the mockery. From noon to 3. The whole earth was dark. Around mid-afternoon, Jesus groaned from the depths, crying out loudly, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, "My God, my God, why have you abandoned me?" Some of the bystanders who heard him said, "He's calling for Elijah." One of them ran and grabbed a sponge soaked in sour wine and lifted it on a stick so that he could drink, but the other said, "Don't be in such a hurry. Let's see if Elijah comes and saves him." But Jesus, again, crying out loudly, breathed his last.
Oh. But Jesus, again, cried out loudly, and he took his last breath. At that time, the temple curtain ripped in two from top to bottom. There was an earthquake, and all the rocks were just split into pieces. And what's more, tombs opened up, and many bodies of believers who were asleep in their graves were risen. After Jesus' resurrection, they left their tombs, they went into the holy city, and were seen by many. The captain of the guard and all those who were with him, when they saw the earthquake and everything that was happening, were scared to death. They said, "This has to be the Son of God."
Jesus walked in days of long ago. I wandered down each path he knew with a reverent step and slow. Change. A sweet peace fills the air. I walked today where Jesus walked and felt his presence there. My path today where Jesus knelt, where all alone he prayed, the garden of Gethsemane, and my heart felt unafraid. I of where Jesus knelt and felt him close to me.
Late in the afternoon, a wealthy man from Arimathea, a disciple of Jesus, arrived. His name was Joseph. He went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate granted his request. Joseph took the body and wrapped it in clean linens and placed it in his own tomb. A new tomb, only recently cut into the rock. And he rolled a large stone across the entrance. Then he went off, but Mary Magdalene and the other Mary stayed, sitting in plain view of the tomb.
In letters of crimson, God wrote his love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died and love's greatest story.
crucified my Lord. Were you there when they crucified my Lord?
After the Sabbath, as the light of the new week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to the tomb to keep vigil. Suddenly the ground began to reel and rock under their feet as God's angel came down from heaven, came and stood right where they were standing. He rolled the stone away, and then he sat down on it. Shafts of lightning blazed from him. His garments shimmered snow white. The guards at the tomb were scared to death. They were so frightened they couldn't move. The angel said to the women, "There's nothing to fear here. I know you were looking for Jesus, the one that they nailed to the cross. He isn't here. He was raised, just as he said. Come and look at the place where he was placed." Then he said, "Go and tell his disciples, He is risen from the dead. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. You will see him there. That's the message. The women, deep in wonder and full of joy, lost no time in leaving the tomb. They ran to find the disciples. Then Jesus met them, stopping them dead in their tracks. He said, "Good morning." They fell to their knees, embraced his feet, and worshiped him. Jesus said, "You're holding on to me for dear life. Don't be frightened like that. Go and tell my brothers that they are to go into Galilee, and I will meet them there."
Thank you. they looked at him and saw a simple man, a carpenter with healing in his hands. They saw him calm the sea and heal a dying man. They saw, but could they really understand? They could not, they could not. Though they tried, they could not. He was just a simple carpenter, but with healing in his hands. But could they really understand? They could not. They listened to the teaching that they heard and wondered at the mystery his word. They wondered what he meant about a father's plan. They heard, but could they really understand? They could not, they could not. To his teaching about a father's plan, but could they really understand? They could not. So finally, upon a rugged cross, they killed the man who would not suffer loss. And when at last they took what willingly he gave, he died, but could they keep him in the grave? They took from him what willingly he gave. Could they keep him in the grave? Could they keep him in the grave? Could they keep him in the grave? They could not, they could not. Praise God. What willingly he gave, could they keep him in the grave? Could they keep him in the grave? Could they keep him in the grave?
Thank you. The roar.
as the music lingers in the air, as the reading of Scripture continues to permeate our souls, we go back in imagination to that scene before Caiaphas, where the high priest very pointedly asks Jesus, "I charge you, I adjure you by the living God that you tell us whether you are the Messiah or no." And Jesus responds, "It is as you say, and henceforth you will see the Son of Man seated on the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." It's almost as an echo of those words that John the Revelator writes right near the beginning of the book of Revelation, that every eye will behold him. So as we recognize the power and the meaning of the empty tomb, we also long for that day when we too shall behold him coming on the clouds of glory, and thousands times 10,000s will sing his praise. So while we celebrate the empty tomb, we also clearly look forward to the coming of our King. On that day, we shall behold him.